Hi, thanks for having me. Thanks for the invitation. It's nice to be here. I'm Tim Latsutko and I'm a PhD student and reverse engineer at the Ruhr Universität in Bochum. This is a talk that I gave with Moritz Kontakt beforehand at Recon this year. And well, yeah, we did some work on code obfuscation via program synthesis. So this is based on prior work that we published on Usenix security last year in August. And in this time, we give a more practical version of that. So basically, we will discuss three different things. First, obfuscated code and its relation to semantic behavior. Then we will have a look at traditional code obfuscation techniques. And finally, we will have a look at a semantic-based orthogonal approach, namely program synthesis. So, but let's get started. So, what is code obfuscation? Code obfuscation is a technique that has a goal to prevent or to complicate reverse engineering attempts. So, for instance, if you're a company that wants to protect your intellectual property, or if you're a malware author and you want to prevent the analysis of your payload, or you also find this in DLM systems. So, however, we marked complicate instead of prevent because to set the scene, there's one well-known statement from Martin Slaughter, one of the authors of Bioshock, the computer game. He said, "We achieved our goals. We were uncracked for 13 whole days." So it's more than making stuff more complicated instead to prevent it. But this is how it goes. So how do we protect software? Let's just have a look at the early days. In the early days, we had something like that. We had our common tools such as IDA Pro or Olli Debugger. We had our file parsers, and they all had well-known bugs. And authors started to just exploit the bugs such that Olli Debugger crashes if you open the binary that you want to analyze. Or they started to prevent something, to introduce something as doing debugger checks. So, however, these kind of countermeasures have some problems. Namely, if you Google, "game does not start, debugger detected," you see this happens quite a lot. So, because of that, we don't focus on something like that. Instead, we have certain requirements regarding code obfuscation. First, we want that a technique is semantic preserving. That means that the obfuscated code behaves the same as the unobfuscated code. It just looks more complicated. Second, we assume a white box scenario. That means we don't require hardware dongles or things like that. Instead, we want to focus on code only and assume that the attacker has access to every binary he wants to analyze. And finally, we want techniques which are more or less effort to deploy from the view of the company than the attacker to crack it. So it should be easy to deploy and hard to crack. So for instance, doing some anti-debugging tricks, as you've seen it before, they are basically a one-to-one effort. The company patches this in, the reverse engineer patches this out. So it isn't really a win for both sides. So let's have a look at some well-known code obfuscation technique called OPRAC predicates. So we start and have a simple control flow graph of our function on the left-hand side. And we can make it more complicated just by adding additional branches and additional basic blocks. So, however, the code itself does the same. Let's zoom in. What we have is something as a comparison that is a conditional comparison that is based on an API call of the return value of get current process and some comparison. If it's true, we go there, otherwise we go to B. However, why is this something like that an OPRAC predicate? Well, basically, we always take this branch. Why? Because the API function always returns this value. So basically, we compare if the value is equal to that value, and this is obviously the case, and we go every time to block A. So block B would be dead code. We can just change it, and just change the constant here, and then this branch is always false, and this is always true. We can also do it randomly. So we just jump on a random value, and in this case, block A and block B have the same behavior. They look different from a code perspective, but they do the same semantics. So this is something called a random OPAC predicate. So in general, they increase the complexity of the analysis. And OPAC predicates can be built on hard problems. For instance, on pointer arithmetic, on checksumming, on equations, and things like that. And they force the analysis to encode additional knowledge. For instance, the how to handle API calls, or they have to include checks or some reasoning rules about inequalities and things like that. However, they are hard to solve statically. However, if we have an execution trace, that means we run the program, observe the executed instructions, we basically solve them for free. Why? Well, because we see where the program goes and we aren't interested in any other branches at all. So let's have a look at some more complicated code obfuscation techniques. Virtual machines. So our current scenario is we have some code that we want to protect. And well, if we open the binary in either Pro or our well-known tools, we can just see what is happening inside. So what we want to do is to make this more challenging. So what we can do is we can just replace this with a made-up instruction set. So basically, replace this code by pushing some bytecode and calling a virtual machine. And then if we analyze something like that, we just see some code of a virtual machine that we don't know. So we would have to first reverse engineer the virtual machine, and afterwards abstract the higher level semantics of our original code. So VM consists of different components. We first have VM entry and VM exit. So basically, at some point in time, we leave our native code and jump into the VM code. For this, we have a context switch, and the entry basically copies in the native context, such as flags and operations, to the VM context. And at some point in time, we leave the VM, we have a VM exit, so basically we restore the native context. We have a VM dispatcher. This is just a software CPU. This is our fetch decode execute loop. So we fetch some instruction. We forward the virtual instruction pointer. We have a handler table where we look up the next instruction and then we execute the handler. So what is a handler? Basically, one handler represents one instruction of the virtual CPU. It is mainly a table of function pointers indexed by the opcode of the instruction. One handler per virtual instruction, so we have an XOR, an add, a push, or whatever we want to have. And each handler on its own decodes the operands and updates the VM context. So we have something like that. This is an unobfuscated VM. So, and what we can do is we can just match the simple components one to one. So we see we have the VM entry here. And then we have a fetch decode execute loop. We see basically here are the different handlers, and each handler jumps back to this loop. And the loop itself just looks up the opcode and branches to the next handler. One handler here doesn't go back to the FDE loop. This is a VM exit that basically exits the VM. Okay, if we see something like that, this is rather simple. We can also have a closer look. So the VM dispatcher Basically, it has a virtual instruction pointer and a VM context, and here it jumps into one handler. And just have a look at the one handler. Basically, this handler performs a NOR. And on top of there, we read two arguments from the stack. We perform NOR here. Then we write back the result and update the flag. And then we jump back to our VM dispatcher. So this is rather simple. We may ask, well, okay, how can we complement, how can we make reverse, how can we harden this such that reverse engineering is more complicated? So first, we can have a look at the handler itself. We have seen they are normally really simple. But we can just apply traditional code obfuscation transformation, such as inserting OPEC predicates or junk code or instruction substitution or things like that. Then we can also duplicate VM handlers. So our current scenario is that we have one VM handler that performs, for instance, an addition. And if the reverse engineer knows that this handler does an addition, he just has to analyze the remaining handlers. However, we want to increase the workload of the reverse engineer. For that, we can just apply different code transformation rules and create handler duplicates. So what does it mean? Well, this is our traditional code table where we have a push, an add, a NOR, and a pop. And we can just, we just shuffle it and create copies of them that look different on the code level. And then the reverse engineer has to analyze all these things instead of all these things. Okay. Then we had a central VM dispatcher, and every handler jumps back to the dispatcher. Something like that allows easily to reconstruct the control flow of the VM. So what we want to do is we want to get rid of this central dispatcher. Instead of branching to it, we just inline it. So basically, this was our scenario. A handler jumps back to the central dispatcher, and the next handler is invoked. Now, we just execute a handler, and it performs the inlining here and calculates the next handler, and so on. So this is a technique that goes back to the 70s that is called threaded code. And finally, we want also to get rid of the handler table. Up until now, we had an explicit handler table, and if we know one entry, we can just analyze all the other handlers because we have a data structure that contains all the handlers. How can we get rid of that? Well, basically, we extend the how we call the instruction. Basically, the opcode consists of an opcode and two operands, one handler, and we just extend this format by adding the address of the next handler. So this is basically also goes back to academia, to the 80s, and is called a direct threaded code. And finally, we can blind the VM bytecode. For instance, if we have a handler that performs some checksumming and checks if some checksumming of the code parts are true or something like that, we can easily patch the handler such that it always returns true and the check itself isn't really really important anymore. How can we prevent something like that? Well, we add some kind of flow-sensitive instruction decoding. So basically, we deploy a custom description rule per handler, and patching requires re-encryption of the subsequent bytecode. So what does it mean? So basically, here, we fetch the operand, we fetch the context, we calculate the next handler, and jump to the next handler. This is how it looks like before. So now, we just add some unmangling. We just fetched an operand, and then we have to decrypt it somehow with a key. And then we update the key, and for calculating the next handler, we just also have to decrypt the next handler. And something like that, basically we have one key per handler, it's a lot of more difficult to patch something like that. Okay, finally, one other code obfuscation technique called mixed Boolean arithmetic. So, what does this expression compute? We have an x, x or y, plus 2 times x and y. Well, this looks rather complicated, however, it's just the same as x plus y. Okay, this might be still easy. What about that? So, this is basically the same as x plus y plus z. However, if you see in code something like that, you may not directly think that it's just an addition. So you may ask, okay, starting there, how can we go to there? Perhaps we apply Boolean identities, such as the De Morgan laws or something like that. Or what about applying arithmetic identities? So at one point in time, you will see that there's no easy, obvious way how we can simplify it to that. So why is this the case? Basically, we have a Boolean algebra that combines two different things. Namely, the Boolean algebra consisting of operations such as AND, OR, and NOT, and XOR, and stuff like that. And then we also have the integer modeling. So basically, we have all operations such as addition, multiplication, division, modulo, and things like that. And this in a combined theory. So, and to simplify something like that, there's no general technique that does it easily. So, deobfuscation. What is the state of the art in deobfuscation? Let's go back to our handler, our NOR handler. A very common technique is called symbolic execution. You can imagine this is somehow a kind of computer algebra system for assembly code. So, taking the first instruction, we say, well, this is just an assignment to RCX of the first memory cell. The same goes for the second instruction. This is just an assignment of the second memory cell for RBX. And we can go on. We have not RB, not RCX, and we just have some value, some mapping, such that we can replace it with not RBP. And the same for RBX. We know that RBX is just the same as the not of the second memory cell. Now it starts getting a little bit more interesting. We say we have an AND of RCX and RBX. If we just replace the values, we have something like that. We have not the first memory cell and not the second memory cell. And we, in our computer algebra system, we have also some common simplification rules. And one rule now might be, well, this is just a pattern, this is typical for NOR. So we can just replace it with a NOR. And then the same, we write back the result here, and we learn this is just a NOR. Then also finally, we update the flags and calculate the next instruction. So what we get basically is a capture of the whole semantics of the handler. However, its core semantic is just a NOR that we want to learn. We don't care about all the other details. So this is assembly code of a VM instruction handler. If we symbolically execute that, we get something like that, capturing the whole semantics. However, still, its core semantic is a NOR. Having a look at some C code, this is an MBA obfuscated expression. We compile it into assembly code and just interested in the return value. Well, this is just a symbolic formula for the return value of array X, and it doesn't really fit the slide. What is its core semantic? Well, it's rather simple. To come back, basically, symbolic execution captures the full semantics of obfuscated code. It is a computer algebra system and has some degree of simplification. However, its usability decreases with the increasing syntactic complexity. So let it be artificial complexity, such as code substitution, or algebraic complexity, for instance, MBAs. So the question remains, well, is there a technique that can reason about semantics only instead of having the look at the syntax? And well, the answer is yes, namely program synthesis. So what do we do in program synthesis? Basically, we have the same function, but we just call it f. And we treat the function as a black box. So basically, we say it has some inputs and it has an output. We just can generate random inputs, execute the code, and observe its output. And then we store the input-output sample. We do it not once, we do it several times. We take another input and store the output. And do it again. So we do that several times. And then we want to learn a function that has exactly the same I/O behavior. So we just use f as a black box to generate something like that, and then we learn something similar. For instance, that is this x plus y plus z. The question is, how can we learn this? How can we synthesize programs? So basically, we consider program synthesis as a probabilistic optimization problem. We have a surface here. And each point on the surface is basically a program one possible program. And we have a global maxima, and the global maxima is a program that has exactly the same I/O behavior. And we can assign a concrete score, how good we are, how close we are to the global maxima. And in a probabilistic optimization problem, we start somewhere and have a score and try to improve the score until we get a score of 1, basically, until we reach the global maxima. We do this with an algorithm that is called Monte Carlo tree search. This algorithm is one of the main reasons why AlphaGo was able to beat world-class human Go players last year. Okay, how does this work? Well, let's illustrate this on the example A plus B modulo 8. First, we have to somehow generate programs. We define a context-free grammar. We just say we have a non-terminal symbol called u. And we have some production rules that can be replaced u. Basically, u plus u, u times u, a or b. We say a and b are our input variables. And a candidate date program is everything that consists only on input variables and some operations. So it doesn't contain any u. On the other hand, if we have some u, we cannot directly evaluate it because we don't know what u is. So we call this an intermediate program. And now Monte Carlo tree search. We start with a node u and generate our search tree. We just randomly apply the production rules. So we derive a. A is a concrete program because it cannot be derived any further, and we can give it a score because we are somewhere on our surface. We give it a score now. How we do that, we'll discuss later on. Okay, we have a score. Then we go back and derive the next expression, b. And also here, we give it a score. We do it several times. So now we have u times u. We cannot give it a score because we have at least one u. What do we do? Well, we basically do something that is called a random playout. We randomly apply to that expression the production rules of the grammar until we derive a final expression. For instance, something like that. We see the left u is a plus a, and the right u is b times a. And now we have something that we can give a score. And finally, with u plus u the same. We do some random playout, derive something like that, and give it a score. Now, we cannot apply any production rules. So what we do is we choose the best node in a probabilistic manner. This is the highest score, u plus u, and we start again. We apply the production rules, We do a random play out. We give it a score. Then we go back. The score always represents the average score based on based on its child scores. So basically, we have to update it now with this other age and go back. And then, again, we choose the best note, we do a play out, we give it a score, and we update the score. So we do this all the time. And you see, we always choose U plus A because it's, well, it's just the highest score. However, we have a probabilistic algorithm. That means we try to choose always the best score, but we might have a look at different things just to get sure that we don't miss anything. Because in this case, the random playout could be a bad one. So because we missed something, we just have a look in a probabilistic manner. We give it a score, and we see, well, we didn't really improve. So we just go back to this one because it's the highest score, and we derive B times A, B plus A. So remember, we wanted to synthesize A plus B. So B plus A is the same. So we get a score of 1, and we are finished. Well, okay, how can we give it a score? Basically, we generate random inputs, query our black box function, our original code, and observe its output. Then we have our intermediate program, and well, we evaluate it on the same input and get another output. And then we compare the similarity of those outputs and give it a score. And then we take another input pair, observe the output, the other output, and compare the similarity. And again, this time we have the same output. That means we have a similarity of 1. And our final score is basically the average score. How can we calculate the similarity of two outputs? Basically, we have two bit vectors of the same size. And we compare different things. For instance, are they in the same range? So how many bits of leading or trailing zeros are the same? How many bits are different? So the Hamming distance. This is a good metric for operations such as XOR, AND, or overflows. And finally, how close are they numerically? We can have a look at the numeric distance. And we apply all these different metrics because we can have addition, multiplication, multiplication with overflow, bitwise arithmetic. And a mixture of these metrics just covers all different possibilities, such as you get a score. And just give a little demo. So what we want to do is we generate random I/O pairs from a function that has two inputs and performs just an addition of x plus x plus y plus y. And if you want to synthesize that, we basically see we see somewhere and have a really bad score, and then we go up and improve the score. And at some point in time, we get something like that. And here we have a reward of 1. And basically, this is easy enough to apply standard simplification rules. And we learn that it's 2 times the first variable plus 2 times the second variables. So, okay. This is still a probabilistic algorithm. That means another run might have a completely different way. Might take longer, might not take not that long, or might also get stuck in local optima or something like that. So we just run it. And now you see we have the same result. However, we took nearly 16 seconds, and the run before we took about 8 seconds. Okay, how can we use that to synthesize obfuscated code? Well, first we have to discuss how to get code. We can do just static disassembly and choose a path that we want to analyze. We can choose a memory dump, dump a memory dump, and extract there the code, or we can have an instruction trace. And at one point in time, we have code. Let's go back to our handler. And now the question remains, how can we learn its semantics? Basically, we say that everything is an input that we read from, and everything is an output that we write to. So, and then we synthesize each output on its own. So, for instance, let's take RBX, and the two memory inputs over there, and then we just generate random values and observe its output, and do it several times, and then we learn that this is a knot. Take another output, RCX, generate random inputs, and we learn that this is an OR. And the same with the final result. It's also an OR. What about the flex? Well, basically, we designed our grammar in that way that it doesn't consider flex, so it doesn't learn these flex. Why did we that? Well, because if you would do that, and we would learn flex and something like that, we would run into the same problems as symbolic execution does. Since we want to abstract away all the different things and learn its only its core semantics, we don't consider flex at all. So finally, we just learn that NOR, the two NORs and that NOT, compare it to the whole capture of the semantics based on the obvious, on the symbolic execution part. Okay, how can we do I/O sampling, generate input-output pairs? Well, there are lots of ways to do it. For instance, you can just use the debugger of your choice and just dump the inputs and the outputs and modify them at runtime, for instance. We can also do is via dynamic binary instrumentation, for instance, take PIN or Dynamo.io. We can also emulate it using the Unicorn engine. Or we can do symbolic execution. We have a symbolic formula. We can just feed it with concrete values and evaluate it. So we can do that, but it's obfuscated code. It might took really long. So it's possible, but it's not the first selection. So how we have one special case, instruction traces. In the instruction trace, for instance, we observe that we go to block A here. So, however, we are working with random inputs. So that means with random inputs, the behavior of check might differ, and so the conditional flag here might be different, might be true and false one time. So, however, we want to get sure that we have the same path. So, therefore, we just ignore the flag here and enforce the execution to consider block A. Otherwise, if we saw block B in our trace, we just ignore it at all and go to enforce block B. So we implemented something like this in our framework called Cynthia. This is the program synthesis framework for code deobfuscation. It is written in Python. It performs random I/O sampling based on Unicorn, and it also applies MCTS-based program synthesis. We open sourced it under GPL version 2 and also added all our samples, so check it out. And we will give a little demo. Okay, let's start with some MBA. This over there is the unobfuscated version. We have 5 inputs. And we perform just some operation and return it. If you scroll down, we have its conversion into MBA, which is, well, a little bit longer. Then we compile it and execute it, and then we get an instruction trace. That is rather long, if you just count the lines, we see it's about 800 lines, round above. So, okay, let's synthesize it. First, we do some random sampling.
So basically, we read the instruction trace in the raw format. Then we define the architecture. x86-64-bit. And then we say we want to consider 20 input-output pairs per output. And finally, we just write it into some JSON file. Let's check how long it takes. Around 3 seconds. And if you have a look, typo. So basically, this is our inputs, our 5 inputs, different outputs, and then we start sampling and we have a long, long list. Then we feed our synthesis engine with that. We just apply the sampling file and store the result also in a JSON file. Again, this is a probabilistic algorithm. That means we might finish in within 3 to 10 seconds, or it might take longer, or we might find anything and then have to start again. So in this case, this seems to take a little bit longer. Can just start again. And now we finished in 17 seconds. And if you have a look at our result, we see basically we have something as we read the first memory value times the third memory value plus the last memory value. So basically this is the same as our unobfuscated C code was. Okay, this was based on random sampling, based on some code emulation. But we can do also other things. So what we have here is a function that basically takes 3 inputs and compares these inputs and compares the inputs. Basically, it compares the response of compute response against another input and checks if it's the same, and then it applies authenticated, otherwise try again, something like that. And what we do is, this is basically our core computation. We do an MBA obfuscation first, and then we use Temaida to virtualize it, the MBA obfuscated expression. So if you have a look in IDA, we basically see on top of here we read the inputs. Here we basically provide the inputs for the function. Then here we compute response. Then we check the return value against our last input, and then we jump. Your credentials do not match, or you are authenticated. What we can just do is set a breakpoint before and change some values, and then observe the output in EIX. And so we use that. For instance, we just execute it. Now we have a breakpoint here before the call. we can modify some values, for instance, just modify EX. We can do something different. Then we execute it, we jump to the next one, and then we can just observe the output here. And we can do that several times and store it into a JSON file, and then they basically do the same. So now we have a JSON file, and then we just use sample synthesis again. We have three IO pairs. We write the result back. And if you have a look at the result, we see, oh, this time it wasn't successful. Let's start again. So this time we see it is the multiplication of the last value plus the first value times the first value plus the second value. So basically it's some permutation of our original code. Okay. So basically, we were able to synthesize an expression that was MBA obfuscated and inside of a virtual machine. So this as a core, how can we use it to break virtual machine-based obfuscation with all the hardening techniques applied? So basically, let's illustrate it as all the examples of all the different hardening techniques. This is a rather more complicated expression in just a VM handler. This isn't five to 10 assembly lines anymore. It's about 400. So, and still we learn its core semantic is something like that. Basically, we synthesized a different handler before in the demonstration. Okay. We learn it's just an addition. Okay. What about we have handler duplication and we have a large amount of VM handlers? Well, we synthesize each handler of its own and learn its semantics. And if there are some handler duplicated, we just learn it. So what about VM code blinding, so having some keyed functions inside the handler? Well, basically, you saw two slides ago before that we synthesized this handler. If you have a look, this is just additional semantics. We might cover it with program synthesis. Probably we don't. And however, this something like that doesn't have any influence on the underlying code semantics. It's just an addition. So therefore, we don't care if you get it or not. The same. We have no central VM dispatcher. That means we inline the calculation of the next handler at the end of the handler. So here it is the same. We might get something, but we still get the core semantics. However, this inlining has a nice side effect that we can use in the slide above. So code inlining and calculating the next handler address has as a result that we have an indirect branch at the end of the handler. We can use that in an instruction trace by splitting in indirect control flow transfers to cut an instruction trace into its different handlers. So we don't have any explicit handler tables. This is our last hardening technique. Well, but we can do an instruction trace and simplify that. So first we have an instruction trace. Then we apply the heuristic from the slide above that we just cut this trace at indirect transfers and get something like that. And then we can learn each handler on its own and get something like that. So basically, we learned large part of the arithmetic trace for free. Okay, there are three takeaways. Basically, we showed that the syntactic complexity is insignificant for a semantic-based approach. The semantic complexity is low within certain boundaries, for instance, arithmetic handlers. They just do really simple operations. And if we are able to choose start and end point of sophisticated code in a reasonable manner, there are high chances that we learn its semantics. And finally, we showed that we learn the underlying semantics despite code obfuscation. So in other words, program synthesis is an orthogonal approach to traditional techniques because it has a look at its semantics instead of the code itself. However, of course, it has some limitations. We discussed two things. First, implementation shortcomings. That basically means these are shortcomings of Cynthia, but are not really challenging at all. We just implemented it. So the first one is how to choose meaningful code window boundaries. So for instance, in the case of VM handlers, it was rather easy. But how about we have MBA obfuscated expressions? Well, if we have something like that, we learn that this is an addition. But if we cut earlier, if we have just that, we don't learn any meaningful at all. So then constants. Our grammar doesn't support constants at the moment. So if we have some expression like that, we don't really learn it. What we would have to do is just implement some kind of heuristics, how we can learn constants in a grammar-based way, and then we would be able to learn something like that. The same for control flow operations. We focused on arithmetic operations and chaining them. However, there's no reason why we cannot choose conditional operations too. Of course, now let's come to the general limitations. So we had a look at I/O pairs. So that means that we require that for the same input, we have the same output. If this isn't the case, if we have some kind of non-deterministic functions, well, we cannot do anything at all. Then, of course, semantic complexity. We have a semantic-based approach. If the semantic, however, is too complex, well, then it's too complex. And finally, point functions. Consider a function that has a large input space and returns, in most of the cases, zero, just if some condition, for instance, the check of a constant is true, it performs one. If you perform random sampling on that, it is very likely that we just always trigger the zero case, and in this case, we don't learn the other case. So this is also a problem. And now, to conclude, we published everything. Please try it at home. There's a GitHub with all the samples, all the code. And finally, we talked about obfuscation techniques. We tackled symbolic execution for syntactic deobfuscation, and we introduced program synthesis for semantic deobfuscation. If you have any questions, feel free to ask now. Otherwise, I'm around here today and tomorrow. Just talk to me privately. So, yeah. Thank you very much for your attention.